My name is Jaap Beyader, and I'm head of UX at eMachina. Yeah, I think average order value is important right now because it's the cheapest way to increase your sales. So you don't need to invest a lot to get results. And that's really important, especially now in the COVID-19 situation. If you look at the whole average order value, you really need to look at your segments and see what your segments are doing. And if we look at the tactics that we're using, then we have three categories where they all fall in. So we have up and cross-sell tactics, we have incentives, we have discounts. The first basis to look is have a look at what are the fastest growing and fastest declining product categories. So that is a way to dive more into cross-selling and really dive into those categories. For the up and the cross selling, I think it's really important that you select the places where you want to do it. So I think there are a lot of powerful places you can do it in your card, in your mini card, or even in your confirmation email to get it in touch with your order.
A typical way to do it is to look at your prior user behavior, but my understanding is that given COVID now, we're seeing very new behaviors. So it's difficult to rely on prior behavior in a situation to make recommendations when everyone's behaving in a new way.
If you look at the product categories that are popular right now, you could use that behavior. So there is a little bit known because now we're, I think, almost 4 to 5 weeks into this situation. So we already learned a thing. So if you're shopping for a tent, then you could shop a set and you tie it together with a sleeping bag or a inflatable bed. So you really sell the products together as a one offer, which works really well.
Okay. One thing I've noticed is because we work with rituals, and I think one of the things they do very well is their sets, and they have seasonality around them. They have themes.
Yep.
Do you have any insights into how someone would go about that? Because e-commerce can often be take our products, we put the descriptions online, we sell them, that's it. And it's another way of thinking about it. And something also that doesn't necessarily happen in a physical store, where you can start to create these bundles and wrap them in content and themes.
Yeah, I think that the themes really work as an inspiration and they're really important. So also when you look at fashion, so you could sell an whole outfit based on inspiration and things that really match well together. So it's not only on user behavior, it's also on the what the specialist thinks are good combinations for you to buy.
Yeah.
So you're shopping the look, so to say.
Yeah, that can also be very good. I've seen that done very well with fashion advisors who will come in and certain, a well-known influencer or something, he'll say, this is my set. And they'll create lookbooks and things. Works very well. Seen that work on with some Instagram marketing campaigns very well too.
Yeah, and I think another step that you can do now as well, because if you have your shopping personnel sitting at home, they can do advising on multiple pieces of multiple clothing as well. So it's more a live chat where you do the up and the cross sell.
Okay,
it works really well.
So it's a digital personal shopper.
Yeah.
All right. How tricky is that to set out from a UX point of view? How challenging is that? Certainly I could see in this situation where if there's a lot of people in retail who are stuck at home and you could turn them into personal shoppers, if you could make that easy enough, I guess, how challenging do you think that is?
Actually, it's quite simple. The challenge is not in the technology because it's really easy to install a functionality like that. I think the challenge is in educating store personnel. So you need to train them a little bit on how the platform works and how they can assist in actual selling. But also, since that is quite common technology, it's not that difficult. So you can set it up quite quick and it really works well.
Tell me about incentives then. When you use the word incentives, typically that's because it can be quite a broad term. So what are the sort of different things that you would bundle under the label incentives?
One example is on your shipping threshold. So if you're almost there, then you can add all kind of products to get to the threshold. and you can show really visual cues for that, and that works really well.
So what would be an example of a visual cue?
So from a UX point of view, you could have a progress bar displayed all over your commerce platform, okay. Not only in your checkout or in your cart.
Okay, almost like as it fills up, and when it hits a certain amount, then you qualify for free. For free delivery. Okay, yeah.
And you don't only need to do that for the shipping. You can do it with gifts as well, or you can do it with promotion. So there are a lot of incentives that you can work with. I think a loyalty program is a really good example of that. But a loyalty program is a thing that if you want to implement it, that is not a thing that you can do quite quickly. So it is a thing that will take some time.
Yeah, absolutely. And you want to be careful because there are some, you know, classic issues where discontinuing a loyalty scheme is a problem. You know, you don't just make one and take it away because people have their points. They expect to be able to redeem them. So once you put it out into the world, it usually has to stay out into the world. And if you want to change loyalty schemes and move points across, it creates let's say long-term commitments. You want to go to one of those things.
But it can be interesting also if you have those segments into place that you can tailor the experience to what people are doing actually. So if people are not spending a lot, then you really can go into cross and upselling, whereas you're more into your higher tier of shoppers, you can give them the loyalty tactics and those kind of things. And we see that gifting works quite well as well. So if you meet a certain threshold, then you get a gift as an incentive.
And then there's the third category, right, which is discounts. So
discounts.
Something to be had with care, because discounts can lower. On first impression, you might think that giving discounts is going to lower the average order value, because if you include the cost of the discount in the order value. So how do you use a discount to then drive a higher overall order value?
So I think what you should do when you offer a discount, and you see some smart examples of that, is that you offer your discount on a second product. Mm-hmm. So basically you're buying your first one for the full price, and adding a second one will give you the discount. Or if you buy multiple products, your discount will go higher, so to say.
Okay.
And yeah, what you say is really true. So if you have a lot of discounts, and that is what you see in these days as well, if you have your stock sitting in your store and you want to sell them with a lot of discount, that has a really negative influence on your average order value, because you really want to ditch your stock cheap, so to say.
Yeah.
And that is an actual COVID problem that occurs right now. The other thing, if you look at, because a lot of behavior that you see right now is that people are buying bulk, how do you say it? They buy a lot of...
Buying in bulk, yeah.
In bulk. And what really can work for that is that you offer those products in a bulk promotion.
Right.
So if you buy a lot, you get a little bit of discount. So that is a tactic that really works right now as well.
Have you seen, and I'm wondering how relevant it is to now, how you would think about things like doing time-specific offers, creating either a sense of urgency, but also that can align with the need to move stock quickly?
No, sure. Yeah, so that's a thing that you see quite often now as well. So you really see a time ticker beneath your product. So you need to act now to buy it. And yes, that acts, if that works. It's not purely for your average order value. So it's also a conversion tactic.
I mean, there's a lot of little details in here, but I think that's what the playbook is for. Do you have any? So if someone's interested in these sorts of things, what's the process for them?
So the process would be, you cannot just start and implement 40 tactics, because then you never know what's going to happen. So the start here would be do first a little bit of research. So what is the benchmark for average order value in your category? Then we would say, let's have a look at how the people behave on your platform. So we will divide the audiences in three categories. So we have the low spenders, the medium spenders, and the big spenders, and we will look at their behavior. So why are people only buying one product, and why are they buying a lot of products? So what are they actually buying? And then we can see the what the best opportunities are, basically to tackle the average order value issues.
Do you see it then in terms of figuring that out? Do you see with live testing where you might do A/B testing on a live site with different features and offers the way to go, or is this something best done in a more controlled kind of test lab?
So once you define your opportunities, then you can select the proper tactics and say what experiments you want to do. And every tactic you need to A/B test to see what it does. So never blindly implement it. Just do it as an A/B test, see what it does for you, and then continue.
Okay, and that's something you would generally recommend doing it on the actual live shop if possible. Great. And you've said at the beginning that this is a average order value is a really good place to look because it's the cheapest and simplest to implement quickly. Yep. So what are the why is it the cheapest and simplest? What is it as a group? As an area that makes it able to do that compared to other areas? What is it about in general?
So let's say if you want to increase your traffic, you need to invest. So you need to create campaigns and those kind of things. You need to invest in SEO. You don't need to do it here. So basically, if you want to do some up and cross sell, that is like default functionality that almost every e-commerce platform has. Right. And the same is true for incentives. You can really easily do that basically, and discounts as well. It's a lot of these things are done with default functionality.
Right. Yeah. So the tools are there in whatever platform you're using normally. Then it's just a matter of saying, okay, we're gonna implement it, we're gonna integrate it, we're gonna do the work to make sure we've got the right offers and the right content in there. We're setting the numbers right in the products.
Yeah. And the thing is, you're doing it with the people who are already buying on your platform, so they're already there and they're already buying, and then you just confront them with certain tactics.
Yeah, like they say, the very old bit of wisdom is the easiest people to sell to are your existing customers.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, great. Okay, well, thanks for that. Good luck with the rest of the day.
Cool. Thanks, Ollie.
Okay, cool.